this dog with a bow. So I have a plan for this evening, and I will unfold that to you. I'm going to talk to you for a little while, and then we're going to do some practice together. I'm hoping as really to illustrate what I'm talking about. For those of you who were in the workshop yesterday, we had quite a feast of practice and discussion, and all kinds of things were brought up. And what I want to do tonight, if you were in the Thursday workshop, I'm going to be trying to organize some of what we talked about, and then the practices and the conversation around that you have not been exposed to. So hopefully this will be another step for you folks, and then accessible to everybody else. So we talk about the body in Buddhism, quite a bit. And every, Buddhist tradition, almost without exception, includes some reference to the body. And even if you're talking about paying attention to the breath at the tip of the nose, which is the most commonly used meditation technique in Buddhism, really the breath is an aspect of the body. So Buddhism does know about the body and uses it to some extent. The Vajrayana tradition within this, Vajrayana is a form of Buddhism that developed in the forests and the jungles and the mountaintops of India sometime around the 3rd or 4th or 5th century of the Common Era, and it was not well known in India at all. In fact, we have records of Chinese pilgrims who visited, 500, 600, 700, and there's no mention of Vajrayana. They didn't know anything about it. They talked about the 18 schools of Buddhism and the great Mahayana universities, but there's absolutely no mention of Vajrayana. But we know from historical records, later records, that it was going on. So this Vajrayana tradition is really, it's a different approach, shall we say, to spirituality. My university teacher in my PhD program was Mircea Eliade, who was one of the greatest historians of religion of the last century. And he used to say that Vajrayana Buddhism, that Buddhism was big enough, this very really different, from other Buddhist approaches. In the Vajrayana, the body is the working basis. Now, the important point here is we are talking about the physical body that we know about, the body that all of us are sitting here, and we feel our body, and we think we know our body somewhat. We have ideas about our body. And most of all, we have experiences of our body that we take to be reality. What happens in the Vajrayana is you are very gradually, you're introduced to a very different experience of the body. As we were talking about yesterday, instead of knowing the body in the conventional way and in terms of conventional experience, you begin to know the body through a series of practices that enter you into it. It's possible to develop awareness in every part of your body that is not awareness of me looking in, but it's actually my consciousness connecting with the consciousness of the body. According to Buddhism, the ego consciousness is very limited. Neurobiology has suggested that we, of all the experience that is known to the body and that is received by somatic awareness, the conscious ego only knows a few parts in a million. So what happens in the Vajrayana is you are introduced into practices that help you begin to tune in to the awareness of the body itself. We can look at this, in terms of trying to make sense out of all of this. We can think about neuroscience, and we can think about the discoveries over the last century and a half of the very different functions of what used to be called the left brain and the right brain. The left brain is the thinking mind. It has the famous three L's that characterize it. It's linguistic. You can think about it. You think about experience. You can give words to it. It's logical. You can analyze what you're thinking about. And it's linear. One thing builds on another. But the thing about the left brain, the thinking mind, is it cannot experience anything directly. This is why when we are cut off from our bodies, as we largely are in modern culture, many, many people report that they feel completely out of touch with their own human life. And this is not some kind of vague, paranoid thinking. It's actually a statement of fact. The more the left brain thinking mind is isolated from the larger domain of the body, or what I call the soma, the less experience there is in the way of direct visceral feeling of being alive and, the entire sensory realm and our emotional life and our somatic intuitions and what the body's telling us. We're completely cut off from that, and we feel arid and dry and dead. So the right brain, on the other hand, and I know for everybody at CIIS, I'm just reviewing, the right brain is it's the realm of pre-thought. It's the realm that receives experience before we think about it, before we attach labels to it. Now, it's interesting that nowadays, neuroscientists don't talk about the right brain anymore. In fact, Dan Siegel says we shouldn't call it the right brain, because really what used to be called the right brain, which is the realm of direct, non-conceptual, naked, unprocessed, unmediated experience, includes the right brain, the limbic system, and especially the amygdala, the place where we have immediate feelings of safety and danger, the brainstem, where we feel threats to survival, the heart, all of the feelings and the sense of interconnection of the heart, the gut. When we say I have a gut feeling, that's very literal. The throat is another processing center. And in fact, what used to be called the right brain is not only what I just mentioned, the so-called subcortical regions, beneath thinking, but actually all the way down to the cells themselves. The cells of our body each have their own style of awareness and their own receptivity. So Dan Siegel says, basically we can talk about the left brain, but then we have to talk about the brain of the body. And he doesn't even like the term brain, because it privileges in the wrong direction. So I call it the soma. This ancient Greek term, and it means the totality of the knowingness of our body and our left brain, our right brain. Sorry. So the interesting point is, it sounds all very accessible and logical, but in our culture, the thinking mind, and what the thinking mind knows and the conclusions it comes to are so highly prioritized that actually we don't, most of us really don't even know what it means to experience the soma, this subcortical, naked, experiential field of unbiased awareness, which the body is. We don't even know what that's like. We have no experience of it in our culture. In the Vajrayana tradition, the entire emphasis is on entering into the soma, entering into the body, and conducting, not only conducting the path, but conducting our life from that standpoint. So what analogies can I come up with to, you know, suggest what this is like? Do you know how sometimes you're in a situation and there's a lot of things going on and you have your own ideas about it, and you walk out of it thinking you know what's going on, say an interpersonal situation, and then you go to sleep and you have a dream, and the dream shows you what was really going on. You see the dynamic, you know, between yourself and someone else. You see what you were doing. You see what the other person was really up to. And sometimes dreams can be, you know, very heavy in terms of cutting through our own mental ideas about a situation and showing us the bare facticity of it. Dreams that I've had in my life, and I'm sure you were all very similar, have changed the course of my life, showing me that a whole side of things that I had not seen. Dreams, as Arnie Mandel says, dreams are actually the voice of the body. Dreams are one of the ways in which what the body knows is communicated to us. So the body is it's a very vast and very profound resource, and it has certain, you know, if we can say, well, you know, I know what my conscious mind knows. I have a sense of that. You know, I know what I know. I know where to get information. I know how to think about things. I know how to analyze things. I know how to come to logical conclusions. But what's going on with the, what's called the uncultivated field of awareness that is the body? You know, what's going on there? For one thing, and this is, you know, basically Vajrayana Buddhism. So what I'm doing tonight is I want to just sort of, I want to share some perspectives of this very unusual tradition and how it approaches the question of non-dual awareness and healing. So one characteristic of the body is what's known as complete openness. And what that means is that although, you know, we talk all the time about boundaries, we have to have good boundaries, the body doesn't have any boundaries at all. We certainly know from biology that the body itself, you know, the skin is permeable, and the body is in constant exchange on a physical level with the world around it. We know now from the discovery of mirror neurons in neuropsychology that the emotional life of the body is very much connected and very much entrained and in tune with those around us. And we know from astrophysics and cosmology that the body, that the information from the ends of the universe in the form of electromagnetic energy, and probably dark energy and dark matter, permeate the whole universe, and the body is open to that. So what we're saying here is that the body not only doesn't have any boundaries, it's in connection and in, from a certain point of view, in aware connection with the entire universe around it. It's complete openness. Everything that is going on in the universe, even on a very subtle level, is actually known in the body and by the body. In Buddhism, this dimension of the body is called the Dharmakaya. It is that depth of the body of an enlightened person that is infinitely open and sensitive and aware. But the Vajrayana point is, this is not only the body of an enlightened person. This is the final reality of our own body. Our own body at this moment has that fundamental kind of infinite and infinitely sensitive and open awareness. The purpose of Vajrayana Buddhism is to tap us into that fundamental level of our own being. When we talk about boundaries, it's a scary fact that the reason we set up boundaries is because of what the body has already received, if you see what I'm talking about. The reason we set up a boundary is because the body is open and without boundaries, then we sense there's a problem, so we set up a boundary. But the boundary is a boundary in the conscious mind. It's not a boundary in the body. It's impossible to shut down the body because of this infinite field of awareness. So the first aspect of the soma is the openness. Our body is open. And when we, as Dan already suggested in his introduction, when through the practice of somatic meditation, we are able to touch and tap into that openness, we find that at the basis of our human personality, there is an experience that is timeless. We find a part of ourselves that is open, it's vast, it's infinite, and actually it stands outside of time. My favorite book illustrating this is, I mentioned Thursday, is Jill Bolte Taylor's book, My Stroke of Insight. And there she talks about having had her entire ego mind, her thinking mind, her linguistic, logical, linear mind knocked out through a massive stroke. She experienced her body as being here, being present, but being everywhere, and existing in a time that was outside of time, what's called the fourth moment. In Vajrayana, they talk about touching eternity. When we talk about immortality in the great spiritual traditions, we're not talking about the immortality of the ego, needless to say. But we are talking about discovering that who we really are and what is really fundamental in our state of being is not born and does not die. And that is eternal life, because life at that level is eternal. So the other thing, and this is where the Vajrayana becomes kind of interesting in relation to the other non-dual traditions, that that fundamental nature, what we call the true nature in Vajrayana Buddhism, our true self, strangely enough, on the one hand, you can say it's infinite. You know, we experience it. I mean, we're talking about somatic experiences here. I just want to make that really clear. We're not talking about ideas. The experience of it is that the space of our basic nature is infinite, and at the same time, that it has no, it's outside of time. Sounds very universal, sounds very generic, but it isn't. That's not how it's experienced. We experience it as the most personal, intimate experience that has ever happened in our life. And we experience it as, you know, we all have experiences, well, this is me, and this is what I do, and this is how people see me, and this is what I think about myself. You know, that is a certain kind of experience of ourselves. But this experience is different, because this experience, when we touch it, we feel this really is who I am. This is ultimately what it means to be me, is to be this timeless and infinite fundamental awareness in me, this this very, very deep, what's called the groundless ground. When we touch that, there is the, that's what realization is. You know, we experience a tremendous sense of freedom. We experience a tremendous sense of sympathy and compassion for the world. And we experience a very great joy to have found this out about ourselves. That fundamental field of awareness, and this is what is interesting in the Vajrayana, that fundamental field of awareness beholds the world in a certain way. It's very oriented to this world and these people and my life and my karmic situation, my city, my block, my apartment, my parakeet, my dirty refrigerator, my bad knees. It's very, 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 it's completely grounded and completely tuned in to this life and this world. And what the soma beholds is that this situation is a moment in the perfection of the universe. That this life of mine is a completely unique, unprecedented, and absolutely immaculate expression of the deep, deepest depths of the sacredness of the universe. It's perceiving the world as perfect. And that includes, this is the great conundrum of the of Christianity, I know, and of all spiritualities, it includes all of the life and death we could ever imagine. That's all part of the deep and miraculous display of the universe. It's a, you know, if we just rest in the emptiness of the openness, that's not bad. But a deeper perception of non-duality is the amazingly joyful, interconnected dance of all phenomena. What phenomena brings to us as spiritual practitioners is an enormous sense of appreciation and blissfulness and joy. Experience is joyful. Relative experience is joyful. Even depression, even fear, and no less so than happiness and perception of beauty and so on. When viewed from the standpoint of the soma's depths, everything in the universe is bathed in its own perfection. So that's the perceptual part of the soma. And then the third aspect of the soma, those of you who are Buddhist scholars, we're running through the so-called three kayas of the Buddha here, just in case you're interested. Number one is Dharmakaya. What I just talked about is the Sambhogakaya. And if you're not a Buddhist scholar, don't worry about it. It really doesn't matter. And then the third thing about the soma is that it provides guidelines for life. And I'm trying to think of a way to explain this. Some of you may be aware of the focusing movement started by Eugene Genlin in the 60s at Chicago. I was at Chicago as a student when he was there teaching this focusing movement. Did anybody know about that? Have you studied it at all? Yeah. He discovered, and the fascinating thing about Eugene Genlin is he got it from Buddhism. So that's really interesting. A lot of people don't know that. He got it from Heidegger, and Heidegger got it from Buddhism. So we have this interesting circle is complete. But anyway, Genlin said, if you sit, and he wasn't a Buddhist, but he's working on this one aspect of the body, and you put your awareness within your body, and you feel the weather there. Like, what's the weather in my body right now? what is the general cultural environment of my body? In whatever language you want to use, there's a felt sense. It has nothing to do with thinking going on in your body. And then you you bring before your body a problem. Your body will tell you. The body shows you. And he gives the example. He has a student named Ann Weiser Cornell, or Ann Cornell Weiser. Which one? Yeah, thank you. And the example is somebody's trying to figure out if they should move. Is it to Oakland? I think it might be to Oakland. You know, should I stay in Boulder? This is just like I'm making up. Should I stay in beautiful Boulder, Colorado, where we live? Or should I move to Oakland? And the thinking mind is going to, you know, try to like add up the pluses and minuses. And the thinking mind might go, are you crazy? Like Boulder. I mean, it's like number one city in the world. What's the problem? You know, get a life. But if you ask your body, you bring up Boulder, and your body goes, And you bring up Oakland, and you see in Oakland possibilities opening for you. There's a kind of feeling of light and life and openness and challenge and risk. And it's all somatic. You know, there's no thinking going on. So that's an example of how the... you know, we're talking now about the enlightened status of the soma. The soma is enlightened. If you want to think of it, about it this way, the thinking mind, when it takes over, we have huge suffering because the thinking mind isn't really in touch with what's going on. But the body is. And when the thinking mind is tuned into the body, then we have a very happy situation. And, you know, frankly, in Buddhism, that's what's called realization. When the openness of the body, when the experience of natural perfection, you know, is going on and we're tapped into that, and when we learn how to take the body as a guide, that's what enlightenment is in Buddhism. Now, you might say, I thought enlightenment was like something else. I mean, what I'm talking about here is about this life. It's a way of being in this life, but a different way from the paranoia and the greediness and the arrogance and the aggression and the bad feeling and the self-hatred. You know, all of these mental patterns that we get into, I thought enlightenment was like getting rid of all of that stuff and, you know, getting out into some other space. The Vajrayana is about realizing that when you're in that other space, which we would call traumatized space, you're checked out at that point. And what we're trying to do is, rather than get out of it, we're trying to get into life, get back into life and into what the soma knows. So what happens in the Vajrayana, there, you know, the Vajrayana, I can't speak for other forms of spirituality, but for this tradition, we're not really talking about a religion here at all. We're not even talking about Tibetan Buddhism. We're not talking about India. We're not talking about some cultural tradition. We're not talking about some particular interpretation of reality at all. And this is a very, very offensive, I think, to many people in the modern world who are really looking for a religion. They want answers. They want a form of spirituality that has some kind of status. What we're talking about here is how to live our lives, how to be human, how to experience the openness that within us we feel is possible, we can't get to it, how to get over judging and criticizing everything in our life to the point where we can't enjoy anything and our relationships are like completely twisted. You know, this deep desire to get over it and the deep desire to live in a way that is free and open and spontaneous. And that's really that's what the soma offers. So in the Vajrayana, you know, whatever you want to call it, they have a series of practices that help you tune into the awakening that is already present, the freedom that's already present, the what's called pure perception, that's already present, and the fundamental sense of how to live one's life that is not based on agenda. It's based on the soma. It's based on somatic feeling. So what does this, all of this have to do with trauma? And pretty soon we're going to practice. And even if I'm not finished what I'm going to say, I'm just going to turn the switch and we'll practice. But I do have one more thing. What does this have to do with working the trauma, all of this? This tradition, those of you who know Mahayana Buddhism will recognize this, the Buddhism of compassion, of which Vajrayana is a more yogic, more somatic development, says that there are two veils that get between us and the kind of life we're talking about, the kind of life that we long for. The first veil is what's called the veil of conflicting emotions. It's klesha varna in Sanskrit. And what it means is, it means that, you know, we are so upset. More and more people now are upset in the world, and we're all upset. I'm upset. Everybody's upset. And we have all these like emotional upheavals, all these neurotic meltdowns, all these freakouts, and they come up in, you know, different personalities. They come up in, you know, a sudden wave of self-loathing or a sudden upsurge of hatred and aggression. Or we suddenly feel paralyzed by paranoia. Or we feel incredibly needy, like emotionally we're starving to death, or we're suffocating. And these emotions are triggered by different situations, and they come up, and as you know, they really particularly, you know, for a person who gets angry a lot, it really gets in the way of our life. It doesn't mean we're angry all the time. In fact, you could get angry once a month, but if it's the wrong person, for example, your spouse or your boss or your child, it can be very, very, very damaging. So we have this kind of stuff going all the time, and it's kind of our, it's a thing we don't really talk about. We don't really talk about it, and, you know, with our friends and in our culture. It's this thing we try to keep control of, and, you know, we don't want people to know really what it's actually like for us. We don't want people to know what actually goes on between, you know, in our families. It's too embarrassing. It's humiliating, actually, that we're so in a way under the control of these, you know, disruptive, wild emotions that come up, or maybe not wild, but just pernicious. And the way that first, it's called the first veil that gets between us and the life we're longing for, the way we work with it is the practice of mindfulness. We have heard a very great deal in our culture of late about mindfulness, and people are making fortunes by teaching mindfulness, and people are becoming famous by teaching mindfulness. And mindfulness is not that hard to teach. You know, there's one person who's very famous who did a program, you know, for like a week and then set himself up, and he's famous today. He's a famous mindfulness teacher. It's not that hard to teach. You know, you just sit there and pay attention to your breath. And it's very powerful in terms of calming down, of down-regulating these, kleshas or what are called these conflicting emotions. It's very, very powerful. And the mindfulness practice does actually help us down-regulate. And it helps us begin to feel like we have a little bit more control. I mean, we still get upset, but we have this practice we can do to bring ourselves down and bring ourselves back. It's very reassuring. It's in a way, in the Mahayana tradition, now we're back to Buddhist history, in the Lotus Sutra, there's an example given. The practice of mindfulness is like people who are on this long caravan, and they're going through the desert, and it's very dry, and they're dying of thirst, and they see an oasis up there. And they arrive at the oasis, and they relax, and they, you know, the camels are drinking water, and they drink water, and there's beautiful fruit in the trees, and there's grass, And that's the practice of mindfulness. But the thing is, you can't live in the oasis forever. If you want to arrive at the city of enlightenment, or in our case, the city of full realization of your human life, you can't just stay at the oasis. You have to move on. And what they're saying there is, in our language, that it's fine to downregulate. It's fine to have something that helps you, you know, come back to yourself and be a little bit more peaceful, be a little bit more self-contained. But the practice of mindfulness does not address trauma and cannot address trauma. That's basically what's being said here. The second veil, and this is the one that's really important for us here, is what's called Janyeya Avarana. And Avarana again means veil. And Janyeya is a future gerundive in Sanskrit. And what it means is the what there is to experience. It's a veil over what there is to experience, or what we could experience, which is what I talked about, the complete openness, the natural perfection, and the impeccable guidance of the body. You know, that's what we could experience. But there's a veil over that. There's something that gets between us and that life. And that's the second veil. And the interesting thing about the second veil is that is exactly what we mean when we talk about trauma in our culture. It's very, very interesting. So what are the characteristics of the second veil? Number one, it's the obscurations are unconscious. We don't see them. It's what we call it implicit memory in psychology. That's one of the terms for it. It's unconscious. They are emotional assumptions that we have about how things are, but they're unconscious, and we don't know their assumptions. We just think that's how it is. And they're also beliefs about reality that, again, are unconscious. We don't see them. For example, each one of us has a certain feeling. You know, you look out at the world, and you have a certain feeling about how the world is. And you look at other people, and you have a certain feeling about other people. It's a somatic sense, a feeling. And the interesting point is, if this were an objective, you know, if we were accurate in this, we would all feel the same way and believe the same thing. But the thing is, every single human being has a different reality that they experience. Some people find the world a deeply, deeply unsafe place. I mean, here's the thing. We all feel all of this, but we specialize. So some of us specialize in how unsafe the world is. And others of us feel that people, like in my case, my whole life, I've never trusted men. You know, and if we want to look back, when I was two, my father went to war, and he was gone for 3 years. But I thought men were basically not trustworthy. And then I also never trusted women. You know, and if we want to go back, my mother probably had Asperger's and was simply not on deck. She was a lovely person, a very deep motivation to help people. But emotionally, there was nobody home. And for a tiny baby, that's not very helpful. You know, you're reaching out, and there's this person that is clueless about what's going on with you. Well, you know, my whole life, I've assumed, until I met Caroline, which is, you know, often how it goes, I've assumed that women just were not there, not really available, they don't really care. I mean, they've got other things going on, you know, so it's like up to me. And I've, you know, finally at this stage of life met some male friends who are really there for me. And it's changed things. But up until then, that was the reality I lived in. And I assumed it was that way. And others of us feel that it's not safe to go out of the house. Or we feel that anything we try, we're going to be defeated. or that nobody's ever really going to see us. People don't see us. And all of these, you know, you can do your own thing. I mean, it would be interesting to do a weekend, you know, where we actually, each one of us tries to write down the assumptions we have about how things are and try to make them conscious. But the point is that all of these unconscious attitudes are not accessible to us because they're unconscious and we just assume they're there. But the problem is they get between us and our relationships, our creativity, and even our perception of the world is tied up and limited and shut down because of these all of these attitudes we have. It's almost as if we live in a dark room and there is one window and it looks in one place, and that's the world that we think is the real world, what we see right through that window in that very limited way. So mindfulness, okay, so where do those come from? Well, in Vajrayana, as in trauma theory, these habitual patterns of perception, of experience, of thinking, and of feeling, all of these sort of rote patterns that we've developed arise out of painful experiences that are so unbearable that we cannot deal with them. And so we turn away from them. The body knows them, and they're present in the body wanting to move through, but the conscious mind has turned away and developed, you know, patterns of avoidance and evasion, so we don't have to feel those feelings. And this applies to, you know, the interesting thing about the Vajrayana is it normalizes trauma. It's basically saying that, you know, you may be, we may be, I may be completely incapacitated by the number and the extremity of the patterns I've developed, or I may be more functional, but no one escapes. Everybody is traumatized, and actually it's part of the human condition that trauma is, it's endemic to human life. So In the conventional Buddhism, it said you can practice mindfulness, and that's really, really great. But you're not going to address your trauma. You can't, because it's not somatic enough. The only way to address trauma or the second veil is through the body. So I want to emphasize that. That's one of the reasons why in Vajrayana Buddhism, the body is so important, because there is no other way to unearth these painful experiences that need to be lived through and felt except through the body. If you read people like Van der Kolk, I have one more minute, he will tell you that coming in to the body is the only route to access the amygdala and the limbic system, which is where trauma is largely stored. And until you access the emotional brain, you have no access to the traumatic experience. Any kind of meditation that is not going in through the gate of the body, it may help you, but it's not going to dismantle the fundamental patterns of traumatic response that Dan was mentioning, that limit our lives so severely. So in the Vajrayana, we have a whole variety of yogic methods, and I want to show a couple to you tonight for beginning to create, number one, a safe foundation in the body for working with trauma, and number two, to cultivate a sensitivity to the feeling of trauma that is deeply rooted in the soma and isn't going to be thrown off by what we find and what we feel. So that's the sort of the view part of it. That's the kind of overview. And what if you're still with me? I'd like to do some practice now. You guys up for this? Okay, so we're going to do, we're going to take a practice and we're going to explore it in three different ways. And we can do this, we can do it sitting in a chair. In fact, it's probably not that much choice at this point. If you're deeply inspired, you could lie on the floor, which we did, yesterday, but for this practice, you don't need to at all. Okay, so take a few breaths. You know what I said about mindfulness? You know what I said? What I just said about mindfulness? I could get in a lot of trouble for that. Wouldn't be the first time, actually. Okay, so here's the practice. We're going to breathe into our lower belly, and this is similar to when we did yesterday, but it's not the same. We're doing something quite different now, but we're going to begin with that, and then I'm going to ask you to take a medium to full in-breath into your lower belly, visualizing that you're breathing into what's called the lower dantian, or the hara, or the secret place in Tibetan Buddhism. On the in-breath, breathing into it, medium to full in-breath, and then on the out-breath, breathing out, and tightening down the lower belly. Now, you might say, well, we're not really breathing into the lower belly because the breath only goes into the lungs and it doesn't really go into the lower belly, so what's that all about? The fact is, we do breathe into the lower belly, and we know, from medical research that when we put our attention in a particular place in our body, and we visualize that we're breathing into it, it actually increases the exchange rate of oxygen in that place. Very, very interesting. Even we're talking about the outer breath. What we're working with, though, here is what's called the inner breath, which is the energy that is in the outer breath, in the normal breathing process. There's an inner breath called prana or chi, and that's what we're working with in the lower belly. So when we breathe in and when we breathe out, it has a very powerful, energetic impact on us, and that's what we're going to be exploring here. If you have any discomfort in doing this, the breathing is slow, but it's quite vigorous, and if you feel any discomfort, just back off. Don't push yourself into any kind of realm of discomfort. That's, you don't need to do that. You can do this very gently if you want to also. Okay, so we're going to do it, and then I'm going to ask you to look at a couple things, all right? So we'll just begin by kind of figuring out what's going on. We're going to breathe into the lower belly. So we're going to pick a place midway between the perineum and the navel, in the center of the body, and just very gently breathing in and out. Just try to, feel what it's like to have your attention there. And just relax. Just relax yourself into your lower belly on the in-breath. So now we're going to take a medium to full in-breath, and we're going to empty out and tighten the lower belly down as much as we can, imagining that we're emptying out every cubic millimeter of air. Of breath from the lower belly. So we'll just do one breath like that so you can see what it's like. Okay, medium to full in breath, slow. And then breathe out, breathe out, breathe out. We're not huffing and puffing, just breathe out, tightening, tightening the lower belly, pulling the front of the lower belly back toward the spine. until you're really empty, and then breathe in again. Okay, so we're going to do 12 of these breaths, and I would encourage you to apply as much vigor as you feel comfortable doing. You can apply a lot if you want to, or like I said, back off if that feels better. Okay, so please begin 12 breaths into the lower belly. And if you get done before me, just do a few more. And then let's all do one more together. Medium to full in breath, and then a long, long, very strenuously applied exhale. And when you've finished exhaling, try to exhale a little bit more, and then hold your breath out. Okay, so one more, just for a few seconds. One more. Breathe naturally. And feel your body. Now I'd like to invite you to put your awareness behind your head. We're going to start with the palate. So breathe in through your nose and feel the coolness of the breath at the back of your palate. And then we're going to open our attention behind our head. We're going to open the back of our head and extend our awareness backward. See if you can do that. And try to open and let go backward. You go back and you think you've got it, and then you have to let go and you have to open backward again. How far back can you extend your awareness? The awareness isn't sleepy. Notice, it's awake, it's alive, and it's open. Okay, so we're going to do this one more time. Actually, we're going to do it a few more times, so just to warn you. And we're going to do something, we're going to go a little further. Okay, so 12 breaths into the lower belly. Please begin. Once again, if you get done before me, just keep going. And then all together, let's do one more, and at the end of the out-breath, breathe out a little bit more and hold the breath out. And this time, look behind your head while you're holding your breath out, okay? So one more breath. And then just breathe naturally. So we're going to open a gate in this space behind our head. So I want you to pay attention. Put your awareness once again moving from the coolness in the palate and then opening backward. So let's start doing that again. Opening our awareness behind our head, feeling the field of space behind us. And notice it has a visceral feeling to it. It has a somatic feeling. There's a feeling to the space. It can be very subtle. And then opening backward. And staying with that feeling of the space behind you, behind your head, I'm going to count to three and say go. And when I say go, I want you to imagine you're parting a curtain in that space behind your head. And the instant I say go, there's going to be a big something on the other side of that curtain. I want you to just look back there, okay? One, so we're behind, opening backward, feeling the somatic feeling of the space. There's a seam down the middle, and I say, oh, we're going to abruptly part it. And look. One, two, three, go. then do it another time, and this time part the curtain, and I want you to see if you can dive through the opening with your awareness, your conscious mind. See if you can dive through backwards and let go into it. One. So we're behind, we're in the space, we're feeling the somatic feeling, whatever it is in that space, and there's a seam down the middle. One, two, three, go. Just let yourself tumble in the space behind. What is it like? What do you see? How does it make you feel? Notice the different quality of the space on this side and the space on the other side. When you part the curtain and step behind the curtain, you're in the quantum space. You're in the true nature, in the Rigpa. In the fundamental soma, in your true body. But to arrive there, we have to let go. And the 1, 2, 3 go helps us. Okay, so one more time. So coming back to the palate, just feeling the coolness. And then extending behind. And feeling the space behind the throat. And opening back. A certain tangible somatic feel, a seam down the middle of that space behind us. One, two, three. space goes on forever, and you can fly and fly and fly through it. And come upon all the wonders of the universe. You feel ready to come back? I came home. Even though we're touching something very vast, it's very much a matter of personal experience, and it's something our whole body experiences, and something our whole body responds to. So I want to show you a variation on this that, which is really, makes the point a little bit more obviously. What we're doing here is we are touching something that is truly us. And it's a kind of paradox because, as I said before, on the one hand, you tumble, you know, you part the curtain and you tumble through into a space that is, there are no reference points. And even you can't say light and dark. And it's infinite. And at the same time, it's me. It's who I truly am. And it's my home. It's a paradox. The most vast and universal and the most personal at the same exact time. And that's what the... That's how we begin to work with trauma. We, in ourselves, as healers, teachers, therapists, meditators, whatever it may be, we begin to discover whoever we are, whatever person we are, whatever life we live, we begin to discover that there is a there's a place of utter safety and a place of utter stability and utter peacefulness, utter calm, utter openness. It's in the focusing tradition, and Wiser Kundal calls it the basic witness. It's a part of ourselves that knows and deeply knows. That doesn't know in a mental way, it knows in an experiential way, and in a visceral way, in a somatic way. And when we have that experience, it disconfirms the version of the traumatized self, the small, shrunken, disconnected, imprisoned, claustrophobic, suffocating experience that we all have when we're triggered, and that some of us, if we're deeply traumatized, live with all the time. So there's a kind of, it's almost as if touching the deeper self, you know, as we just did, a vacuum is created, and it draws the poison out of the traumatic experience into the space, and it begins to soften the ultimate authority of the traumatized mind. When we are, even people who are relatively functional, when we're triggered and we're in that state of mind, it seems like it's going to go on forever. And it seems like it's the truth, even though in a different state of mind, we know it's not so. By practicing in the Vajrayana, by practicing over and over and touching our basic nature in this way, and actually what we did, you know, when you dive through it, you actually surrender your body into the totality, and your body becomes the totality. When you know that as your deepest body, then the trauma loses its sting. And the trauma, and then we can afford to go through what the trauma needs us to. You know, always with trauma, we need to feel through and experience and allow the initial unbearable feeling to make its own journey. Trungpa Rinpoche used to say, my teacher used to say, that even a traumatic state of mind, it's actually like an entity. You know, it has its own being, it has its own reality, it has its own sacredness. And we simply try to cut off its life. And that's why we have these problems. So we let it flow through, having this deep experience of openness and freedom and release in the basic nature. And then we can afford to welcome in the traumatic guest and let that guest tell us what it needs to. So I want to show you just a little bit more, and then maybe we can have a discussion. So now, this is more strictly Vajrayana practice. We're going to work with that very same situation, but in the body itself, within the body, rather than going behind. And we're going to work with it in the lower belly. So do you have the energy to do 12 more breaths? Okay, let's do it. So same exact practice, 12 breaths into the lower belly. And this is the place where people leave. It's okay, no problem. Okay, so 12 breaths in lower belly, please begin. And then when you're finished, you can just rest. So now we're going to breathe into the lower belly in a very gentle way, bringing the breath into this space midway between the navel and the perineum. And you need to kind of figure out where it is in you. Everybody's a little different. So we're going to, once again, as we did Thursday, we're going to visualize a balloon opening on the in-breath in the lower belly, inflating, and on the out-breath, deflating slightly. And as the balloon inflates, I want you to look into the center of that space. Put your awareness right in the middle. On the in-breath, open the balloon up more. Open it up to the point where there's just a space and you're not even aware of the balloon. So your awareness is right in the middle of the lower belly and you open that space up, let the balloon inflate and then fall away. Notice the space in the lower belly is very similar to the space that we found behind the head. We're here. We can feel the body happening around this space, and yet the space itself is completely empty and open. And you can actually expand it out beyond your body. Just let it grow and grow. So here we have a paradox again. We can feel our sensations, we feel the body, but at the same time, space is the fundamental reality, the open, empty awareness in the lower belly. Again, it's home. It's a home. Okay, very good. So we're just we're taking a look, but there are other practices we could do, you know, around the sacred perception and around tapping into the body's guidance. Basically, you know, with all these practices in the Vajrayana, what we're doing is we're disconfirming the whole range of traumatic experience, which is, you know, the ego itself is a traumatic response. The ego is the sum total of all of our traumas and all of the habitual responses we've developed to avoid having to deal with the unbearable feelings, the unbearable pain. I mean, that's basically what our normal ego is. And through working with the true body, the what, you know, Buddhism calls it the body of the Buddha, but it's actually our own body. And working with the purity and the openness and the absolutely reliable intelligence of the body, then this whole sort of ego personality begins to become dismantled. And what is very, very interesting and very important in the Vajrayana is that that we have the false personality, which is the one that we carry around. When we dismantle that false personality, you know, sometimes people fall into a kind of nihilism. Well, then there's nothing there if I dismantle my false personality. But actually, in the Vajrayana, what begins to come into view is your true personality. There is a person. It's a person who has that openness, who perceives his or her world in a certain way, and who is creative. You know, the body is inherently creative. And each one of us is entirely unique. We're a unique event in the universe. And the distinctive thing, I think, about Vajrayana, the Vajrayana approach to non-duality, is the goal is to cultivate, to give birth to, and to cultivate, and to develop, and to express the unique person that we are. We, each one of us, each one of the 7 billion people on this planet came here, was born here, was given birth by the universe on this planet to deliver a unique message of themselves. I often hear Asian teachers, I don't think always understand, the traditional ones, understand the sacredness of the human personality. And often the individuality, the uniqueness, and the creativity becomes lumped under the ego. Well, it's just ego. Well, it isn't ego, not according to Vajrayana Buddhism. It's actually the point of practice. The whole point of this tradition is to give birth to ourselves. And, you know, it's not give birth to ourselves in a kind of narcissistic or egotistical way, but we, each one of us, has a sacred obligation that we feel as an imperative in our body to give birth to the person that we are and to deliver who we are to the universe, to deliver it to the other people, deliver it to planet Earth. And until we fulfill that mission to be who we are and become who we are and take the chances that have to be taken in order to truly individuate ourselves, we're not going to be happy. We're not going to be fulfilled, and we will never experience the joy that is within the human capacity, the joy that we came here for. We came here to experience joy. We came here to experience freedom, and we came here to experience love. And the Vajrayana is about removing the traumatic syndromes so we can be that way, and we can live that way in the world.